especially because a lot of workers, but I can't say that it is ethical.
आर का मतलब क्या है यहाँ पे?
Grievance redressal.
Yes, people. This is everyone done. This table over here is everyone done. Very good. Then these again are some concerns which are important for private institutions. Most importantly, how do you resolve an ethical dilemma? For this, there are 5 approaches that are available to you. Here, let me in fact put this slightly differently. When you are given a dilemma, it is virtually impossible to provide an ideal perfect resolution, but you will still have to take a decision. Any decision that you take must be based upon an appropriate justification. For that justification, there are 5 different approaches available to you. The utilitarian approach, rights approach, justice approach, common good, and the virtue approach. As I start taking a look at them, 2 things I want you to keep in mind. Number 1, each of these approaches has a fundamental justification, but number 2, it also has a corresponding limitation. Which is why the advantages of one approach sometimes become the disadvantages of the other, and vice versa. Therefore, in providing a resolution, try to use one, if possible, try to use a combination of these approaches. The more of these approaches that are satisfied in an answer, the better we will say that that the quality of your decision is. But when I say try to use a combination, it does not mean that you force all 5 into your answer. In any answer, if you are able to use 2, maximum 3, your answer still will be extremely good. Most importantly, by the time I finish with the discussion over here, whoever you are, whatever your ideology, whatever your background, by the time we are done with this, I expect all of you to understand that if there is one nation which consistently tries to adopt all 5 approaches, that nation again is India. And that we are not saying because we are Indians, because to a large extent that is genuinely true. And in India, in one set of institutions, constantly try to follow all 5 approaches. Which set of institutions is that? Not the private sector, that is most commonly your government. Which is why by the time we finish discussing all of this, you must have a genuine sense of gratitude, a genuine sense of respect towards the nation and the government which is serving you. To understand that, let me start first with these justifications. The first approach over here is the utilitarian approach. What does that say? The utilitarian approach says that whenever you're faced with a dilemma, whenever you don't know what decision to take, a very simple justification you will use, take the decision that produces the greatest good for the greatest number. When we use the word number, this now provides you a very easy justification, and this provides you with a very quick decision-making tool. Wherever you find more numbers, wherever there are greater numbers, that is where your decision will lie. Without hesitation, take the decision quickly, that will be the right decision. For example, I am telling you that somewhere in this country, we are considering the construction of a dam. If this dam is made, it will increase energy security for the entire nation. But to build this dam, one particular village will have to be displaced. These villagers who are displaced will be given adequate compensation, will be rehabilitated, will be resettled, but will lose their traditional way of life forever. That is irreversible, that cannot be compensated. Question for you is, should the dam be constructed? What will the utilitarian approach say? It will say, consider numbers. What are the numbers? Let's say there are 300 people living in the village. Energy security for who? For a nation of 130 crores. So will it say build the dam or don't build the dam? Immediately and instinctively, it will say build the dams. In the middle, if their rights are compromised, if their way of life is compromised, the utilitarian approach will not consider that. Similarly, if I say the Armed Forces Special Powers Act, should it continue in force or should it be repealed? What will the utilitarian approach say? It will say it should continue. Why? For larger national interest, in 2 words, what is that called? National security. If I take you back to the first case, that man you had arrested was only a suspect. Should you torture him? Should you not torture him? Utilitarian approach will say torture him. Beat him up. If required, even kill him. Even if you kill him, it is still considered justified because you are doing it for the greater good. Very quick, very simple decision making tool. Wherever you have greater numbers, that is where your decision will lie. Problem with this approach, should I always use the utilitarian approach? Answer is no. Because if I start using it, I will take decision very quickly. Problem is that in this approach, we focus largely only upon the ends, but we cannot give adequate attention to the means. What does this mean? That this approach can tell you what you are trying to achieve, but how you achieve it, in what means, to what manner, that it will not be able to decide. To understand the limitation with this approach, let me take a very simple example here for you. Michael Sandel, have I told you about?
Yes, sir.
Michael Sandel, Harvard?
Yes, sir.
It doesn't matter. If I haven't told you, I'm telling you now. Not now. After your prelims, before your mains, when you're preparing for the mains a little more seriously, there's a professor of justice in Harvard University called Michael Sandel. He has made 12 videos and put them up on YouTube. They're available as a free. Don't watch all 12. They'll get too philosophical, they'll get too confusing for you. Watch the first 3 or 4 videos. Each one is about 40-45 minutes in. To understand the problem with the utilitarian approach, let me use one of the examples he takes. We start with the assumption that you are a person who's currently driving a train. You're going down a certain set of tracks. As you're driving the train, you realize that the brakes of this train are not working. You further realize that farther down the track, there are 5 people working on the same track. If you go down the same track, you end up killing all 5 of them. At that moment, you realize that an option that you have is that the track a little farther down also turns right. And on the right side of the track, there is only one person who's working. Simple question for you is, will you go straight and kill 5, or will you turn right and kill 1? What will the utilitarian approach say? Greatest good for the greatest number, so turn right. You're taking 1 life, but you're saving 5. When I take this, I feel a sense of pride, because I feel that I've taken a very good and a very quick decision. But the same quick decision starts turning questionable as we start changing the circumstances. Why? Because you will not be able to consider the means. In the second situation, we say that again you're driving a train, again 5 people working, again the brakes have failed. But this time, the track does not turn right. You will have to keep going straight. At that moment, you realize that standing right in front of the train, right in front of the engine, is a friend of yours. And this friend of yours is a little heavy. So you realize that if you push your friend, he will fall in front of the train, and because of his weight, the train will stop. Question for you is, should you push your friend? What will the utilitarian approach say? Utilitarian approach will say push, right? Because the principle is still the same. You're still taking 1 life, but you're saving 5. But this time, I start feeling a little guilty. Why am I feeling guilty? Because it is not only the objective, it is also the means that will matter. And these means, most importantly, become absolutely clear when we change the situation a third time. Third time, you're not driving a train. Third time, you're a doctor. In your clinic today, there are 5 patients. All 5 of them are going to die. Why? Because one or the other of the vital organs is not working well. If they get an organ transplant, all 5 of them will live long, healthy lives. And each one of them needs a different organ. One person needs a liver, second needs a kidney, third needs a heart, fourth needs a brain, and so on. Brain is also important. Some organ or another. At that point, if they get those organs, they will live long, healthy lives. At that moment, you realize that sitting in the room next to your clinic is a young man, absolutely hale and hearty. Question for you is, can I take the 5 organs from you? What will the utilitarian approach say? Utilitarian approach will say yes. Why? Because you're still taking 1 life, but you're saving 5. But this now feels like outright murder. Why does it feel like murder? Because you're considering the objective, you're not considering the means. In your exam, what are these means for you? In your examination, these means become for you basic human rights, basic civic liberties, becomes for you sometimes even a question of human dignity. The utilitarian approach will not be able to consider these very means. Now, the case that I'm looking at, the case is not important, the answer also you'll understand very quickly. More importantly, understand what India does, and when you understand what India does, learn to respect your country for what we constantly try to do. To understand that, simple case here for you. This case says that if there's a flight somewhere which has 150 people on board, the flight is hijacked, and the hijackers are demanding that you release 3 hardened terrorists. They say that if you release these terrorists who are currently in your jails, they will release all the passengers safely, but if you do not release these terrorists, they will blow up the plane, killing all 150. You further know that if these terrorists are released in the future, they're likely to plan more attacks in your country and they're likely to cause even more deaths. Simple question for you is, if you had the authority to take the decision, would you release these 3 terrorists or not? Would you release these 3 terrorists or not? If you had my dear friend over there, yes, what would you do? You release them? Let me rephrase this. Should a country, so whether it is India, whether it is Russia, whether it is the US, should you negotiate with terrorists? You should not negotiate with terrorists. No. So should I release these 3 people? You should kidnap the 3 terrorist families. They live in Pakistan. How do I get them from there? Or they live in China possibly? Yes. Which case am I talking about? Where is this from? This is Kandahar. In Kandahar, did we release the terrorists? One of the terrorists was who? So is he planning attacks against you even now? Are Indian citizens dying even now? Should we get your answers? What will the utilitarian approach say here? Should you release or should you not release? Utilitarian approach will say consider the numbers. What are the numbers over here? 150. On the other hand, how many? Great people, those are terrorists. Other side is 130 crore Indians. 150 Indians or 130? Yeah, you know what you're thinking. These are not yours, those are your people. 150 or 130? Great people. Please, I am asking the question, I'm answering the question also. I don't know, you're just smiling at me sitting here. What is more important, 150 or 130 crores? 130 crores. So the utilitarian approach will say that to keep your nation safe, to keep 130 crore people safe, definitely do not release those terrorists. Does India follow the utilitarian approach? Answer is no. This part now understand even better. If as a nation you want to grow, you want to grow very quickly, you want to become very strong economically and militarily, try to use the utilitarian approach as frequently as possible. Who uses this approach? A nation called the US. Israel is not that much of an issue. Another nation called China, a former superpower called Russia. Problem is that when you use this approach, you will grow economically and militarily, but very frequently you will have to compromise the rights and even the lives of your own citizens. To understand that, China, I don't think I need to explain, because this is one country where almost on a daily basis, you have gross human rights violations. But let me consider also countries such as the US. Again, going back to 9/11. In 9/11, how many planes crashed? Four. Not two. Who said two? Four. Where did the first two go? The World Trade Center. Where did the third one go? The Pentagon. Where did the fourth one go? The fourth one crashed, they say, into an empty field in Pennsylvania. When it crashed in Pennsylvania, the question more importantly is what exactly led to the crash? Nobody can give you a different answer. By the time the second plane crashed into the World Trade Center, the Americans realized there was something seriously wrong. By that time, they scrambled their fighters. When the plane finally hit the second, the Pentagon, the Americans realized that they were not going to take a chance. This fourth plane, if you go home today and search for Google Images, for the two planes that hit the World Trade Center, you will find not only photographs, you will even find videos. Third plane, which hit the Pentagon, you will find a lot of photographs from many different angles. Search as much as you want, you will not be able to find any visual images of what happened in Pennsylvania. One stock image you will find over and over again, it will show you a grassy field. At the end of the field, there's a small hill. From the other side of the hill, you can see a lot of black smoke. That apparently is expected to be the plane. If a passenger plane crashes, what will you find at the side of the crash? First, you'll find the wreckage of the plane. Second, you'll find a lot of luggage. Third, you'll find the body parts of different people who've been killed and so on. But nobody knows what is on the other side. Why? To a large extent, unsubstantiated, of course, never confirmed, never accepted by the American government. But to a large extent, rumored is the fact that by the time the third plane hit the Pentagon, the Americans did not know where this plane was going to go. Whether it was headed for the White House, whether it was headed for the US Capitol, they didn't want to take a chance, so what did they do? They shot the plane down themselves. When I shoot the plane down, what will justify that? The utilitarian approach. That 200, 300 people on that plane are not as important as an entire nation with 30 crore people. That is what you call the utilitarian approach. What does it cost? The rights and the lives of your own citizens to keep your own nation safe. If I turn to, who's the president of Russia? Vladimir Putin. Is he a strong leader? Yes. But strong leadership costs what? Strong leadership again costs the lives and the rights of your own citizens. Should India or should any country negotiate with terrorists? Answer seems to be, popular media will tell you, never negotiate with a terrorist. What will that cost you? Your own citizens. In Russia, in September, in fact, 1st to 3rd September 2004, there was an attack in a small Russian city, small Russian town rather, called Veselin. In Veselin, there was a school where Chechen rebels took over the school and took all the teachers of the students as hostages. There were roughly about 1100 people in the school. 1st of September, Russians tried to negotiate with them, negotiations failed. 2nd September, tried to negotiate, again, they failed. 3rd of September, strong leadership, Vladimir Putin did not wait. He ordered Russian special forces to attack the school. The siege after that took about 3 or 4 hours. 4 hours later, all the rebels inside the school had been killed and the school had been liberated. But in those 4 to 5 hours, out of these 1100 people, how many people died? 330. Many of them were children. Is this, but to his credit, I can also say after that, 14 years have gone by, not a single such attack has happened. Question for you is, and in these circumstances, can I say that he took the right decision? utilitarian approach will say yes. But to understand whether the utilitarian approach is right or not, here what will you have to do? In 2018, you will have to go to the families of these 330 people. Ask their families, in 2004, did your president, did your government make the right decision? And there's a high probability they will say no. That it is the responsibility of every single government to try its very best to keep the citizens alive. What is the problem with this approach? That it considers only the objective. It does not consider what means we are using. In India, do we have that understanding? Often, the answer is no. In 1999, when the Kandahar plane was hijacked, did we try to negotiate with the terrorists? Answer is yes. We released all three of them. Not only did we release them, we sent the foreign minister with the plane to Afghanistan to get our passengers back. But the moment they landed back in the city, in the country, who were the first people to criticize them? Not the international media, not the Chinese or the Pakistani. First and foremost, the government was criticized by its own people, by its own media, saying that this is how weak a nation is. Is India weak? Answer is no. India is only trying to uphold and protect the welfare of its own citizens. And to understand whether it should do that or not, consider if you were one of the passengers, what would you want your country to do for you? Problem with the utilitarian approach is that it can focus upon the objectives, it can focus upon the ends, it cannot adequately consider the means that are being used. This is why, yes? That was the utilitarian approach. If you talk about Blue Star, if you talk about any operation that has been taken by the government, that has been taken keeping in mind the larger national interest. The Armed Forces Special Powers, for example, is for national security. And India does this. But India does this on a more rare basis. More as an aberration rather than as a rule. If I say that India is about to fight a war with someone, will you be conscripted into the army? Or will you be asked to join the army? You will be asked. If you want to join, very good. If you don't want to join, they will not compel you. If this was China, where they believe that they are about to go for a war, will they give you a choice or will they compel you? If I consider a country like Israel, Israel follows the rights approach or follows the utilitarian approach? It follows both. Israel is a country that has double standards. It has a very different set of principles for its own people. It has a very different set of principles for everyone across the world. Possibly the exception is the Americans. India doesn't have a high moral standing. Forget that. Who's going to answer the boy in the last row? What do you mean by soft power? If I say SOLT, soft power, POWR, what is soft power? Does India have military power in the global community? No. Do we have economic power? No. Do we have soft power? Yes. What is soft power? What is soft power? The intangible, often cultural influence that you have upon another nation or the set of nations through which you can exert influence upon their decisions. What is India's soft power? In India, for example, you're from Bombay. What is India's soft power there? From Bombay. Forget, what does Bombay give to the country? More than anything else, it gives you cinema. What is that? That's Bollywood. What else have you given to the global community? Yoga. What else have you given them?
Meditation.
What is your soft power? Can I say your fabrics? Can I say your customs? Can I say your festivals? Can I say your monuments? When a person walking in New York right now is, when you tell a person in New York that you're from India, what is the first image that goes in his mind? First image that he'll think about is possibly the Taj Mahal. Or the first image that you think about is holy. Or the first image that you think about is the kind of food that you eat and the kind of spices that you use. What is that? That is India. Are you a peace-loving nation? Of course, you will claim that. Does the international community believe that you are a peace-loving nation? They don't believe that. They believe that. Is India a peace-loving nation? Who will you go and ask this question to? You go and ask this question to the nuclear supplier group. And when you ask them, they will say that yes, we believe you're a peace-loving nation. Because we were created in 1974 in direct response to your nuclear test. And now we are the same nuclear supply group which is willing to supply you with nuclear material. Recognizing what? That you are a responsible, peace-loving nation with a very strong non-proliferation record. Why? Because you don't always follow the utilitarian approach. Most commonly, you try to uphold the rights of your own people and the rights of others. This doesn't even follow. But here in the utilitarian approach, I am not adequately considering the means. To consider the means, yes. Is it not health? To release the, yes. So here, what is the question you should ask? That same turmoil that I was facing. If the flight, what is that? IC-814 was hijacked. The question you should ask is, where is the problem? Problem is not releasing the terrorists. Why? Because I will have to release them if I want these 150 people back. Question you should ask is, why was the flight hijacked? Why is it that you have to hijack? Where did this flight take off from? Kathmandu. Where did it land first? Amritsar. Why did it take off from Amritsar? Those terrorists on board did not have a grenade. They did not have any bombs. They only had guns. If it landed, if it was standing at Amritsar airport, how did you allow it to take off? How many officials were dismissed? How many police officers were dismissed for this? Zero. How many airport officials were dismissed for this? Zero. What did you call it? A security lapse. That's fine. But who's responsible? Who's accountable for this lapse? You're not able to identify. Which is why even today, is there anyone here from Jammu? I go to Jammu, but you said you're from Kashmir also, you're from Jammu also. Both the cities. Very good. Very, very transcontinental kind of a person. Jammu airport. I had gone to Jammu airport sometime last year. I was, Jammu and Kashmir is one of the most sensitive states in India. What I was surprised at was, you can literally walk onto the, what is that, the runway and walk back at wherever you want. I took a cup of coffee. No, generally, I took a cup of coffee, they gave me samosa, I think. I took two samosa and went on the tarmac, sat there very comfortably with my phone. I'm clicking photographs of planes, that was not right. But I was clicking, not a single person stopped me. A policeman came to me and he was walking at me, possibly to ask me. I looked at him a little sunny and said, what? He said nothing and he walked away. Is that the kind of security? And then you have these lapses where entire planes, if I had to go to Pakistan right now, I can tell them at least 3 or 4 places where you can kill a lot of Indians, where you can infect a lot of Indians. Because it is, have you gone to Karol Bagh market? Have you seen, if you suddenly defected to Pakistan, what would you tell the Pakistanis? Tell them come to Karol Bagh. One small hand grenade here will kill at least 200 people. You want to kill even more, go to Sarojini Nagar. And over there, if there's a policeman over there who tries to stop you, what should you do? Give the policeman 100 rupees to go and have tea somewhere. He won't even get to know what is happening in the background. That is the kind of country. How many people have you suspended? Zero. At this point in time, I will have to release these terrorists. There's no other. How long did we keep Azad Masood in jail before he was released? How many years was in jail? I think about 5 or 6 years he was in jail. What are you doing with him? 6 years later, does he have any credible information for you? No, the information is already outdated. 6 years he's been sitting in this room. Then why don't you execute him? What are you waiting for? Ajmal Khasab, how long did you keep him? 4 years. For 4 years, what are you doing? Making a mockery of the entire system. Was any judge held accountable? Answer is no. Therefore, coming back more importantly, the problem with the utilitarian approach is that it can tell you what your objectives are, it cannot tell you the ends. And if you, it cannot tell you the means. And if you do not give adequate attention to the means, the lives, the liberties, even the rights of your citizens may be violated. To ensure that that does not happen, a second approach will have to be used here, which is called the rights approach. What is the rights approach? The rights approach is based upon the understanding that every individual human being, even every individual animal, has certain inviolable rights. These rights, under all circumstances, must be upheld. For example, if I say, does a terrorist deserve legal representation? Which terrorist am I thinking of? Again, Ajmal Khasab. How long did you keep him alive? 4 years. Every year, how much money were you spending on him? Government of India, how many crores? 5 crore rupees on average per annum. 5 crores multiplied by 4 years is how much money? 20 crores. Has the government of India spent 20 crores on any one of you? No, but we spend that on him. So does a terrorist deserve legal representation? Rights approach and the government of India will say yes. They will say that even if you are a terrorist who 2 days back with an AK-47 was killing our citizens, we will still not hang you like an uncivilized society. Why? Because we are not an authoritarian state like China. We are not a banana republic like Pakistan. This is India, and in India what prevails? Rule of law. Many students are going to ask me this question after the class, so let me clarify it here itself. Was it sensible for you to take 4 years to hang him? Let me rephrase. Does this give you any advantage? Yes. Where does it give you an advantage? It gives you an advantage in every international forum that India attends after this. When you go to an international forum and someone questions your human rights record, what is the first thing that you remind them? That we are the same country which took 4 years to hang a terrorist after giving him every legal representation possible. If we are willing to give this kind of legal representation to a terrorist, we'll of course do the exact same for our own citizens. That is the rights approach. Uphold and respect the rights of every single stakeholder who is involved. Similarly, if I say, what do you mean by culling? What is culling? Mass and selective killing. What does that mean? I think this is 2016. I was taking the classes, in between two classes, a boy came to me, literally on the verge of tears, and said that, sir, I belong to the state of Kerala. So I said, what exactly is the problem? He said, sir, the Kerala government has recently taken a decision to kill 175,000 birds. What is the problem? The possibility of bird flu, the possibility of avian flu. So I told him, this is absolutely right. Because if the virus spreads, it will affect a lot more people, a lot more species. He said, no, sir, that I absolutely agree with. He said, my only question is, are you sure that each and every one of these 1,75,000 birds is infected? And if a bird is not infected, why is that bird being killed? Does it not have the right to live? Who will justify this killing? The utilitarian approach. Who will oppose the killing? The rights approach. In the certain, in no matter how, should testing, clinical testing on animals be considered? Answer is no. If it is for medicines, the utilitarian approach will say yes. If it is for cosmetics, the utilitarian approach will still say yes. The rights approach will disagree. Should the state have the authority to take your life? The rights approach will say no. If the government cannot give you your life, it should certainly not enjoy the right to take your life away. Respect the right of every single stakeholder that is involved. Problem with this approach, however, is that if you try to respect the rights of every stakeholder, you are largely focusing only upon the means, and sometimes you may lose sight of the ends. What does this mean? That there will be circumstances where the political, where the economic, societal, or even moral cost of upholding an individual's rights are so high that the ultimate objective itself gets compromised. To understand that, let me again put this in the form of a small case for you. This case says that at the moment, there are some terrorists involved in attacks at multiple locations in Delhi. One of these terrorists has been shot, has been injured by the police, and he is captured. He is taken to the hospital, and in the hospital he is in a very critical condition. As he is taken to the hospital, the police realize that he knows what the plans of the entire terrorist outfit are. They need to interrogate him, they need to question him. Problem is that since he is in a critical condition, the doctor realizes that if the interrogation is allowed right now, this may cost the patient's life, the patient may even die. Question for you is, should this interrogation be allowed? If you were the doctor, would you allow the interrogation?
If the doctor allowed.
Would you? Let me rephrase. If this is China, will the interrogation be allowed?
Yes.
If this is the US, will the interrogation be allowed?
Yes.
If this is Israel or this is Russia, will the interrogation be allowed? Answer is certainly yes. But this is not Israel, this is not Pakistan, this is not China, this is India. In India, which city am I talking about? Not Delhi, this is actually Bombay. In Bombay in 2008, Asmal Kasab was captured. Was the interrogation allowed that night? Answer is no. When the policeman, when the police asked the doctor said, I have two duties. First is as an Indian citizen, second is as a doctor. Had you met me outside, in the parking lot or the road outside, I would have possibly said that you must interrogate him. But when you get this person to me on a stretcher inside a hospital in the capacity of my patient, my first and my most important responsibility is as a doctor. And what is your responsibility now? To try and save this person's life. That is called the rights approach. That under any circumstance, every single person has certain inalienable rights. Those rights must always be protected. Only problem, however, is that if I protect these rights, did Asmal Kasab live another 4 years? Yes. But that night, had that interrogation made out, many Indian citizens who died in the next few days, their lives possibly could have been saved. This is why, to uphold one person's or one section's rights, there will be circumstances where the political, economic, social cost could be extremely high. Which is why there will be circumstances where we will have to place reasonable restrictions on your rights. Your constitution gives you which rights? Fundamental rights. These fundamental rights, are they absolute or can they be suspended? Suspended during what? During an emergency. For what? For greater national interest, for greater national welfare. That greater national welfare comes from what? Greatest good for the greatest number. What is that? The utilitarian approach. This is why we say that the advantages of one become the disadvantages of the other. And this is why again we say that in resolving a dilemma, try to use one. If possible, try to use a combination of these approaches. Before I go to the third one, the first two over here first, does everyone follow? These two, is everyone clear? Alright. Then here, briefly please write a little, and then we look beyond this. Resolving ethical dilemmas. Resolving ethical dilemmas. Under this please write. Under this piece, right? Although it may not be possible, to resolve a dilemma in an ideal manner, comma, individuals and institutions individuals and institutions will have to take a decision. Will have to take a decision in such situations. In such situations. Full stop. Each such decision. Each such decision must be based. Must be based on a reasonable justification. On a reasonable justification for choosing one course of action over another. Choosing one course of action over another. Full stop. As such, comma, there are five broad approaches. There are five broad approaches that can be considered. That can be considered, comma, each with a fundamental justification. Each with a fundamental justification, but also a corresponding limitation. But also a corresponding limitation. Full stop. In taking a decision, comma, one or a combination of these approaches can be used. What's wrong? The more the number of approaches, the more the number of approaches satisfied in a decision, comma, the closer it comes. Closer it comes to being considered ideal. It comes to being considered ideal. Under this design, number one, the utilitarian approach. Should I make you write this? Should I put it up over there? Oh, excellent. This is just a waste of time otherwise. Utilitarian approach, greatest good for the greatest number. Problem is that you're not considering the means. Those means include your rights. Number two is the rights approach. But if you focus excessively upon the rights approach, you may sometimes lose sight of the larger objective. Which is why these two approaches will have to be further complemented, number three, by what we call the justice approach. What is the justice approach? The justice approach says that in any decision that you're taking, treat equals equally and treat unequals unequally. What does that mean? That in any situation, if there are significant differences between two different people, two different sections, those differences must be taken into account in the final decision that you're taking. To understand this on a simple level, are reservations unfair to those who are not entitled to them? Government of India and the justice approach will say no. Why? They will remind you that unequal should be treated unequally. They will tell you that in our society, there are certain sections which historically have suffered severe discrimination, severe deprivation, which is why it is a responsibility of the government to give them an equal competitive platform. Therefore, reservations are fair to everyone, including even the people who are not entitled to them. Similarly, if you look at almost any corporate scandal, any corporate scam, most commonly you realize that it happens because a large shareholder has misused his influence over the company's decisions. This raises the question, should shareholder rights in a private company be directly based on the number of shares that they own? The justice approach will say, yes, treat unequals unequally. And what is unequal over here? The element of risk. The greater your investment in a company, the more the number of shares you own, the greater the risk you are taking. And since it is a greater risk, treat unequals unequally. They should be given greater influence over the working of the company. Should mediation be used in the case of rape? Justice approach and the Supreme Court of India will say no. Mediation, they will say, should be used where both the parties are equal. What does parties being equal mean? Where both the parties are aggrieved. In the case of rape, both the parties are not aggrieved. One party, which is the victim, is deity. The other person is the one who is accused. Do not treat unequals equally. Therefore, mediation certainly should not be invalid in the case of rape. Simple justification. If there are significant differences between two different sections, consider those differences in any decision that you take. Is discipline important? Is discipline? If I say that there's a line where, let's say, people are standing to get some food at a flood camp, if an elderly person comes by, should that elderly person be asked to stand in line or should they be allowed to skip? On what basis do you allow them to skip the queue? On the basis of the differences. They are not equal as far as the physical facility is concerned, as far as the physical capabilities are concerned. So allow, let me put this in a simpler manner. Let's say you people are being given books when you leave the classroom, the books that these people give you. Now, ordinarily, what do I witness? Let's say 10:30 in the morning, there's a line with 20 boys standing there, waiting patiently to get the books distributed. As they're standing in line from the same batch at 10:30 in the morning, a girl comes by. Simple question is, should this girl be asked to stand in the line or should this girl be allowed to skip the queue? At 10:30 in the morning, the answer is she should definitely stand in line. Why? Because at 10:30 in the morning, for all intents and purposes, every single one of you is equal. Treat equals equally, so please stand in line. But if the same books were being distributed, not at 10:30 in the morning, but at 8 o'clock in the evening, 8 o'clock at night, what time does it get dark these days? Around 6:15, 6:30, let's say 6:30. At 8 o'clock at night, the same girl for the same line, should she be asked to stand in line? Should she be allowed to skip the queue? Skip the queue. Why? Unequal should be treated unequally. And what is unequal over here? The relative degree of risk. Especially in a city like Delhi, especially after it gets dark, a girl is significantly more vulnerable to the risk of any form of violence or at least misbehavior as compared to a boy. Only question, what is the problem over here? When I say treat unequals unequally, what would constitute equality or inequality is a matter of personal opinion, is inherently subjective in nature. Will girls be given this exemption at 8 o'clock at night or at 7:30 at night or at 6:30 in the evening? This answer will vary from person to person. And since it will vary from person to person, since it becomes subjective, determining what exactly will constitute justice or a just decision becomes extremely difficult to specify. Therefore, rather than taking a decision that benefits only one person or only one segment, take a decision that collectively benefits all. To collectively benefit all, this is what you call now the common good approach. In a country such as ours, the utility of this approach, the need for this approach is very high, but unfortunately, it is found very rarely. Before I explain this approach to you, here keep in mind, wherever public participation, wherever collective participation is important, the utility of this approach is very high. And collective participation, not only within individuals, sometimes within societies, within institutions, sometimes even within nations. What is the common good approach? The common good approach says that a decision is good where it benefits not only you, but benefits everyone in the system collectively, including you. Promote conditions that are equally to everyone's advantage, including yours. Simple question, if I talk about public participation, for public sanitation, public hygiene, question that a person asks is, why should I not litter outside someone else's house? I keep my house very clean. Why should I bother about not littering outside? Because if you do not keep conditions outside clean, then other than the interiors of a home, the rest of the country looks like an open garbage bin. In India, tax compliance is not even 3%. Tax compliance is roughly around 1.7%. 98% of the people in this country do not pay their taxes honestly, their direct taxes honestly. Why should I continue paying my taxes in a system when 98% of the people are not paying theirs? Why? Because you're promoting a common good. What is a common good? National strength, national capabilities. These national capabilities benefit who? Benefit the others or benefit even you? Benefit every single person, including you. If I consider this on an international level, why should a developed country allow entry to refugees? Why should it allow entry to migrants? Because by doing this, you are promoting a common good. What is a common good? Over here, international and global peace. If you push them back into conflict zones, what will happen? At one point of time or the other, the problem will get more complex and is going to affect you, maybe now, maybe in the future. Promote conditions that are to everyone's advantage, including, of course, yours. In doing this, the problem that we face is, if everyone was willing to do this, you would have people behaving in a very responsible manner. If you're stuck in a traffic jam, should you try to take the car left or right? Answer is no. Because when you do that, what do? You create a larger mess. You create more of a problem which affects everyone, including again you. Problem is that most people will not adhere, especially in a country, will not adhere to this problem, number one. Because when you try to promote the common good, you will have to share burdens. But the sharing of the burdens may be unequal. And number two, this will result in the problem of what we call the free rider. Who's a free rider? A person who wants the advantage of the common good, wants the advantage of that objective, but is not willing to contribute. If I consider, for example, unequal burdens, what does that mean? In India's taxation system itself, there are three different slabs. Some people pay 10%, some people pay 20%, some people pay 30%. The person who pays 30%, his burden is significantly greater, which is why there's a high probability that he'll try to evade, possibly at least avoid the taxes. And number two, as more and more people shy away from dealing with their burdens, this leads to the problem of what we call a free rider. A person sitting in an individual capacity, institutional capacity, sometimes a national capacity, who wants the advantage but is not willing to do his work. On an international level, which countries are free riders? Most commonly, right where we are, India and our neighbor, China. In one climate summit after the other, both these countries will try to shirk their responsibilities. What will they say? They will say that our per capita emissions are low. Are your per capita emissions low? Of course. Because your population is 133 crores, your population is 140 crores. Per capita emissions are bound to be low. But what are you ignoring? You're ignoring the fact that if you do not address climate change a little more seriously, at a later point in time, this is going to affect every country on the globe, every country on the planet, including even you. Which is why promote conditions that are equally to everyone's advantage. To promote them, there is one element that is required, and which is where we start taking a look at it in reverse. If you want every person to do something that is beneficial for them as well as for others, in those circumstances, every such person, which is why again we're discussing this on ethics, must have a good value system. But that value system I come to in a moment. The common good approach, does everyone follow? Then the question for that boy now sitting in the last row, please explain to me the difference between the common good and the utilitarian approach. Utilitarian approach, greatest good for the greatest number. Common good approach, promote conditions for everyone's advantage. What is the difference between the two? That's why I say the paper, the theory is very simple, very straightforward. Application is very important. Number one, what is the problem? If I say there's an approach where the majority benefits but the minority pays the price, what am I talking about? The utilitarian approach. If I say that in one of these approaches you need authority, what am I talking about? If I say you need authority, what am I talking about? Utilitarian. If I say one of these approaches is voluntary in nature, what am I talking about? The common good approach. How do you understand this? India believes that at this point in time, there's a high probability that we may enter a war with Pakistan or China. It wants more and more recruitment into the armed forces. If the people in these classrooms, you are the people who are most likely going to join the armed forces, if you voluntarily go to a recruitment center, am I talking about the utilitarian or the common good approach? The common good approach. On the other hand, most people inside these classrooms say that we are not willing to join. Why should I serve my nation? What has my nation done for me? In those circumstances, what will the government do? They will use the utilitarian approach. Now what will they do? They will use authority. With the authority, what will they order? A military conscription. Whether you are willing or unwilling, as long as you are in the defined age group, as long as you have the physical capabilities, you will be compelled to join the army. Fortunately, so far, India has never had to order a military conscription. Even as we order that, even as we try to adopt the common good approach, why is it that most people will not agree? Because the sharing of the burdens again will be unequal. How is it unequal? There are two people who we want to join the army. First person is a person who passed out of IIM Ahmedabad, got a job for 75 lakh rupees per annum. He is about to join the job when the war breaks out. There's a second person sitting for the civil services exam, three attempts but has not even passed the prelim so far. If I say that both of them are being asked to join the army, for whom is the share of the burdens greater? The one from IIM, because the opportunity cost is very high. In this case, who has a higher probability of becoming a free rider? Possibly again, this person. The other person will see joining the army not as a burden, but most possibly as an opportunity. Here, whoever or whichever of these two joins the army, what is he promoting? He's again promoting a common good. What is a common good? National defense, national security. But where there is this unwillingness to do what you know is beneficial for everyone, including you, how do you rectify that problem? For that comes the fifth approach, which is called the virtue approach. What is the virtue approach? That take a decision that is not based upon others, that is based upon self-direction, self-regulation. take a decision which is consistent with the highest humanitarian principles and values that you believe in, where you don't have to ask someone else what you should or should not do, where you are guided by your own self. To understand this, let me start with a very simple example. Students who on their DEF write that my hobby is playing cricket are very commonly asked this question in the interviews. There's a batsman playing a match. He nicks the ball is caught by the fielder. The umpire does not notice this and declares the batsman not out. The batsman knows that he's out. Question is, should he walk? Should he continue playing or should he walk from here? Let me rephrase. This is an Indian batsman, this is an India-Pakistan match, and it is a final of the World Cup. Should he continue batting or should he walk from there? But you'll probably lose the match after this. Are you willing to lose the final of the World Cup? To do what? No, yes. Is this something that is theoretical or do people actually do this? Which Indian has done this? Which Indian has done this? Sachin Tendulkar, other than Tendulkar. So, Hashim Amla is South Africa. Indian. Which other Indian? People, MS Dhoni. Which Australian has done this? Ricky Ponting, Adam Gilchrist. Which Pakistani? Do Pakistanis do this? Pakistanis also do this. Which Pakistani? Shahid Afridi is a good batsman. He's one of the most explosive batsmen, and even he has done this. Why? Because these people that I'm talking about, are they famous cricketers or are they legends? They're legends in the world of cricket. And why are they legends? Because every time that they stepped out to play, they did not step out to play or to win a match or to win a tournament. They stepped first and foremost to play the game in the spirit of the game. Even if you lose that match, for the rest of your career and for many generations to come, we will quote you as an example of what ideally a person should do. Which is why, if the Tendulkar is playing, who's the best batsman in the Indian team these days? Virat Kohli, let's say Kohli. If Kohli is the person over here, as he tries to walk away from there, the runner, whoever is on the other side, says don't go. The umpire does not know. Should Kohli listen to him or should he walk? Walk. What is this called? Self-regulation, self-direction. In these circumstances, take a decision which is consistent with the highest principles, the highest values you are aware of. But this advice is very easy to give if it is for someone else. If I put you in the case, the answer starts changing somewhat. So here, although I know your answers, let me ask you. In an examination, the invigilator goes off for a few minutes. Everyone in the exam room is very happy. Everyone in the exam room starts cheating. Question is, will you also cheat? I don't believe you at all. Will you also cheat? Now, this is what I need you to understand. This question that is given here, I've been asking in the batches since 2014. Every time that I ask this, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 5th set of batches. Every year, 25 batches. How many is that? That's about 25 multiplied by 125 batches. 125 multiplied by 500 is how much? 125. It's about 62,000. Let's say 50,000 students. About 50,000 students have asked the same question. When I ask, what will you do when everyone in the exam hall starts cheating? What do students do? Students sometimes look at me and they only smile. They don't answer. Their smile can raise a lot. Some students say, no, I will not cheat. I don't believe them at all. Of all the batches that I've taken, one student in 2015. In the Domino's building, evening batch, 5 o'clock, he was sitting on my right hand side. That was one student who gave me an answer which I thought seemed to be correct and where I thought I could believe him. I asked the same question. I said, will you cheat or not? Some people said yes, some people said no, some people are just looking here and there. From my right hand side, second or third row, this is one boy. He said, no, I will not cheat. And the tone in which he said it conveyed to me that he was different from the other. So I told him, I said, before you explain further, first please tell me where are you from? IIT Kanpur or IIT Kharagpur, one of the keys. I told him, I said, before you explain further, also tell us what have you got in class 10th, 97 or 98% marks. What have you got in class 12th, if I had a little, 93 or 94% marks. What is your CGPA in this IIT Kharagpur Kanpur? I think 9.5 or 9.6. Which means that his entire career, he had never seen less than 90% marks. Once the rest of the class heard this, then I told him, now please explain why are you so sure and so confident that you will not cheat. Very simple and very humble answer he gave. He said, sir, because if I cheat in the exam, my marks will come down. If I don't cheat, my marks will be high. What does that mean? That if I try to cheat from a paper, because she knows less than me, my marks will decline. If I focus on writing my paper, I will definitely get better marks and higher marks. What is this called? This is called, in plain simple words, confidence. Or it's called self-belief. And slightly better, this is called an internal locus of control. What is an internal locus of control? That what you should or what you should not do is not defined or dictated by the action and the words of others. It is dictated by you, yourself. What is the biggest problem that we face today as a set of individuals or as a society, as a nation? That we do not have this internal locus of control. We very often have an external locus of control. We compare ourselves with others. We feel a sense of dissatisfaction and correspondingly take those decisions. This one. Do all of you have an internal locus of control? Answer is no. To a large extent, that may not even apply to me. This is one friend of mine. He works in a telecom company. In fact, not telecom, but they manufacture phones. He knows that I deal with your age group. So he asked me, he said, you know, these students who come to your classes, 22, 23, 25, what kind of phones do they use? He's just trying to assess what kind, you know, what the youth is interested in. So I told him, I said, you know, surprisingly, if you come to these classrooms, most of these people are not working. They have not started their careers, and yet they sometimes carry very expensive phones. I said, when I look at the phone, sometimes the phone is worth 10,000, 20,000, 40,000, 60,000 rupees. He said, what do they do with these phones? I said, I have no idea. I said, most commonly what I've seen them doing is, number one, they click photographs. Photographs of what? Their own selves. Number two, what do they do? Then they go and put them up on social networking websites, such as Facebook, Instagram, I don't know where else. He said, then what do they do? They put up the photographs. I said, then they wait. Wait for what? Wait for someone or the other to please go and appreciate that photo. Please go and like that photo. If someone likes it, that's very good. Let's say I put up this photo today, by tomorrow if 25 people like it, I'm very happy. If 25 people don't like it, now what will I do? I feel extremely dejected. I feel extremely saddened. Tomorrow I'll put up. What are these photos? Two people sitting in a cinema hall, watching a movie with Amit Kumar, feeling very happy. That's very good. Focus on the movie. Eating the samosa with Sumit Kumar in Karol Bahar. Only question is why you need to tell the world what you are doing. If the samosa is good, enjoy it. If the movie is good, enjoy it. If these people, but when will I enjoy it? I will enjoy it only when another 300 people tell me that yes, this was a very good decision. Amit Kumar is the person that you want to see. If they do not do that, what does this mean? I do not have an internal locus of control. And what does this lead to? This leads to a person being willing to kill another boy. A class 8th boy will kill a class 4th boy, kidnap him and then kill him because he's not getting the phone that he wants. Do you know how to use that phone? Answer is no. India at this point in time, right now, do we have an internal or an external locus of control? External. Earlier when I made you write those principles, not a single student asked me a question. Our foreign policy these days, is it consistent with Indian principles, Indian constitutional principles, or is it violating them? I was talking about the NPT, I was talking about the fact that you're a very responsible nation. And at the same time, what are you saying? You are saying that we are reconsidering our no first use policy. You're reconsidering that they will not remain only a deterrent. They can possibly use even in offensive, aggressive actions. Where a person does not have an internal locus of control, where does that come from? The right value systems, the right principles. Where you do not have that, the remaining four approaches are virtually impossible to use. But where you have them in reverse now, if a person has the right values, the right principles, he will always take decisions that are beneficial for him as well as for everyone else. Take decisions that show him in the manner that he wants to be seen as. Where a person has these values and these principles, the decision will create advantages for every section of the society, including him. Where you promote the common good, again in reverse, this decision will treat all the people equally or at least proportionately. Where you treat all the people proportionately and equally, you will respect and uphold the rights of every stakeholder. And where you're respecting the rights of all the stakeholders, finally, the decision will produce the greatest good for the greatest number. But all of that boils down to one simple element. Do you have the right value system? Are you adopting the right principles? If there is one country that consistently tries to, I can't say always does, but consistently tries to uphold these five values, it is again your country, it is in India. And in India, which institution do that? Your government. The government has created a document to govern you. What is the document called? The Constitution. The Constitution, why do we say it is a noble document? Does it create the greatest good for the greatest number? Does it provide for respecting everyone's rights? Does it treat people equally and proportionately? Does it? All the questions are answered with a yes. Which is why we say the more of these approaches you're able to satisfy in your answer, closer your answer will come to be considered ideal. But that does not mean that when you, as a student in those 3 hours are writing an answer, you'll force all five of them in. Depending upon the situation, try to use one, maximum two of these approaches to justify your answer. For example, if I consider the adverse impact of climate change, in that case, what do I understand first? That climate change affects everyone, so everyone must contribute. How will everyone contribute? This is the common good approach. Every single nation, every single country will have to play its role. Problem, however, is when you say that all the countries should contribute, you will have to keep in mind that different nations have different capacities. This gives you number two, the justice approach, treat unequals unequally. And what does that give you? The globally accepted principle of common but differentiated responsibility. The more approaches you are able to combine, the decision that you come to will be more acceptable, will produce a greater good. This does everyone follow? Yeah? In this part, of course, I can't make you write. I put it up over there. Before we conclude these three readings over here, please note down. And these please go through at a later point. And yes, and before I forget, please note your schedule also for the coming week. Tomorrow, you have International Relations, yes? IRS. Monday, you have Environment V. Environment V. Tuesday, you have History P. Tuesday, History P. Wednesday, you have Post-Independence J. Thursday, you have SIS. Social Issues, S. Friday, Geography M. Saturday, Science and Technology V. And next Sunday, you have Ethics M. You haven't had a class with Mr. Manikam so far?
We have. Two classes
already. Okay, Ethics M next Sunday. Thank you very much.
Philosophy, I don't know.